Hi, I'm Patty Brennan. I am the director of the National Library of Medicine. I am the fourth appointed director of the National Library of Medicine in its modern state, and I'm the first nurse and the first woman to be appointed to this position. When I was an undergraduate student in the School of Nursing at University of Delaware, I got introduced to the idea of computers, but this was long ago, 1975, and I thought, wow, this could be something really exciting, but then got involved in all the parts of nursing, like psychiatric nursing and intensive care. But later I realized that nurses needed tools to be able to think through complex decisions in the moment, and computer technology in the 80s was really focused on decision support. So that was the direction I took. But I realized that the deep action about technology and healthcare would lay in the hands of patients, building tools for patients to be able to take care of themselves. And that relies strongly on the resources of the National Library of Medicine, where the information about self-management resides. 20 years later, I had been developing a range of tools for patient self-management using virtual realities to envision better households, and then was approached by the National Library of Medicine to come and be their director. My reason why I took this position is because it gave me the opportunity, because we're responsible for all the literature, biomedical literature in the world, to broaden the definition of health and increase the pathways by which we give that information, not only to researchers and to clinicians, but also in the hands of patients. So it took me back to my original goals, helping people take better care of themselves through information and technology. What motivated me to become the speaker at this year's Harriet Cook Carter Lecture was a wonderful invitation by Marion Broom, who's been a supporter and a friend of mine for 20 years. But the opportunity to come to the number one school of nursing in the country for clinical practice gave me a chance to bring the message of what does the National Library of Medicine do to foster nurses' ability to support patients managing themselves, to participate in new kinds of inquiry. The Harriet Cook Carter Lecture gives me an opportunity to bring the ideas together of the National Library of Medicine as a platform for discovery and a pathway for action, and to place it in the hands of outstanding clinicians who can take it out to the world. Data science is a term that's become quite popular in the last 15 years and sometimes mixed or used along with the phrase big data. Let me separate the two of them. Data science is an approach to understanding human health, but at a very granular, at a very basic level, in ways we couldn't understand before, so that the understanding of a person that we develop by talking with them, by looking at their body systems, is complemented by understanding the kinds of behavioral clocks that exist inside their cells, by looking at how walking might be a complex process of muscle, joint, and motion vision response, by understanding that the exposure to contaminated air or to healthful social environments affects a person's lifelong health state. Data science is the tools that integrate the data that describe the health of a person. Now, big data is a phrase that's often used to describe the tsunami of data. Computers have brought us this. The genomic revolution has made more and more data available. And the message is often, when you hear big data, it's scary but important, and we better figure out what's in there. I want you to think about big data as actually being not just lots of data, but lots of data that isn't well-structured, what we call well-behaved, and might be unpredictably valuable to us. So one might never have thought to link the time of rush hour congestion on a bridge in Houston, Texas, with the incidence of out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. But yet, when a bright young scholar started to envision what was it about this neighborhood that was causing an increase in the number of cardiac deaths, they began to look not only at the physical health of the people who lived there and the built environment, but also the amount of pollution that was exposed and how many times a day that changed, and being able to link time of day, time of clinical incident, and experience of a person, we got new insights, not simply into how the environment could affect health, but how specific microenvironments can affect very specific health problems. So big data is a way of framing the understanding of a complex context around a person, and data science are the tools that help us decode that understanding. The most important thing that nursing schools can do to prepare students for a future of what I call data-powered health is to make sure that first and foremost we develop a deep understanding of principled nursing practice that is driven by information. That information may be the evidence generated through research, or it may be data gathered in the moment about how a person's sense of well-being is affected by those around them and medication they've recently taken. Data-driven practice, data-powered health, is a combination of understanding in the moment, interpreting in the moment, and returning to the person. It reflects an engagement with an individual, of their everyday experiences, as well as their history, their genome, and their environment. Now, understanding a person as elements of data, even integrated into a whole, is not enough. Professional nurses must develop a sense of reflective practice. How does this person's experience engage with me? How similar or different is this person from others that I knew? How did what I did with this person, the data I contributed to the circumstance, affect in a good or a bad way what happened to the individual? So the two most important things have nothing to do with quantitative reasoning. That'll come in a minute. It has to do with understanding evidence and the principal basis of practice and understanding the engagement and reflective practice. But importantly, we need to expand the psychosocial and biobehavioral basis of nursing with a data science basis. That includes understanding the importance of formal languages, the importance of being able to connect across a patient's data history, not just an EHR, but what their cell phone's been telling us about them, and also be able to reason in a way that makes appropriate use of things like probability and uncertainty, and use those in a way that helps our patients more. The students entering schools of nursing today have to look to our history of nursing to understand how to best use the emerging data framing of health. Our history of nursing, to me, comes out of some of the great thinkers of nursing, and most importantly for me, Virginia Henderson, who said we should do for the person what they could, would, or should do for themselves if they had the will, the skill, or the motivation. So bringing that idea of what is nursing into a data-driven approach to nursing means we begin to understand a person's skill and will and motivation through data. Means we begin to understand what a person is able to do and perhaps provide them with tools that help them be able to manage themselves. Because ultimately, patients are with us for only brief periods of their lives and they're on their own much of the time. If we're going to understand how to make a big impact for nursing, we need to understand how to help patients understand their own data so that the data collection, whether it's monitoring your blood sugar if you have diabetes or looking at how many steps you take in a day, not only helps a healthcare provider know how a person is doing, but provides a feedback loop to the individual so they know how to take action for themselves.